Hello and welcome. In this video, I'm going to talk about the double T grid and the double T junction. Now, if you haven't seen any other videos on the topic, that's fine. I'm going to walk through all of the basics in this video. But just a word of warning first, I'm not some kind of professional YouTuber, so please don't expect some kind of polished video. This is literally the first video I've voiced over. So here we have a bland and featureless map in City Skylines, and this is a rectangular demonstration city that I set up. If we zoom in, we can see that this city uses a plain square grid formation, and you can see the traffic is running pretty smoothly. If we look at the traffic manager, you can see we're getting a nice 88% traffic flow, which is pretty good for a city this size that only uses small roads. So what trick am I using to get the traffic to run like this? Well, I'm using what I like to call a double T grid. And what is a double T grid? It's a grid made up of double T junctions. So let's look at one of those first. Now I've cleared away some of the buildings from the center of the city to make things easier to see. So I'll zoom into a single double T junction. And this is one right here. Let's center that. Now, as you can see, the traffic in a double T junction enters from two different directions at the same time. From here, traffic enters from the bottom, and then here from the top. So if I switch on the traffic manager, you can see how I've connected up the lanes. So the left-hand lane here goes around the corner into the left-hand lane here, and the right-hand lane goes around the corner, comes out of the intersection in the right-hand lane here, and the same idea for the opposite direction. So if it's set up, let it play, you can see that the important thing about this intersection is that traffic never has to cross the path of other traffic. It can always run smoothly through the intersection, until of course the pedestrians get a green light. Now before I go any further, I'll quickly compare this intersection with the standard ones that people are used to. Now, I'm just borrowing a slide from another video I've worked on, but first I'm going to look at the four-way intersection with two-directional traffic. Now with this intersection we typically have five traffic light phases, one for each of the road directions and one for pedestrians. Now in this case, each lane of traffic entering the intersection will only get a green light about 20% of the time. Now here I'm assuming that pedestrians get about 10% of the green light time, and the rest of the time is for amber lights. So when traffic does eventually get a green light, vehicles get a choice of three different directions to exit the intersection, namely left, right, and straight ahead. So next, from the lane mathematics perspective, we have one lane feeding into three different lanes. Now this is great for removing traffic from that one lane, but it does mean that we are never going to use the full capacity of those three other lanes. Next, I'm going to look at the usual one-way intersection. Now this does improve things in some ways. There are fewer traffic light phases, three in this case, two for traffic and one for pedestrians. So the lane with the green light gets a great percentage of green light time. Now the only drawback with this intersection is that we only get a choice of two different directions to leave the intersection. But on the positive side again, the lane mathematics are also improved. When the lights are green, two lanes can enter the intersection at a time, and these two lanes can feed into four output lanes. Now, this brings us to the double T junction. Here we only have two traffic light phases, one for traffic and one for pedestrians. So if we kept the pedestrians to 10%, the traffic now gets closer, much closer to 90%. Next, we have a choice of two different directions, which is similar to the one-way intersection. Finally, the lane mathematics. When the lights are green, four lanes of traffic can proceed through the intersection at the same time, and those four lanes feed into four output lanes. So you can probably see that this intersection could be a game changer if we can get it to work.
Back to the city now. If we zoom out a bit, we can see another double T junction. First, we can see that while this intersection allows traffic in from the north and south, this one beside it allows traffic in from the east and west, so it's rotated 90 degrees with respect to the one beside it. So while this intersection does not allow traffic to go straight ahead at the intersection, we can go around the corner and then pick that direct the ahead direction after this intersection, and likewise for this intersection on the other side. So that's an important point. Traffic can switch lanes in between intersections in order to change their intended direction. So instead of there being a single point in the middle of a busy intersection to make your decision, you have the length of the road between intersections. So if we zoom out a bit more and see a city block, we can see that the traffic can circle this city block without having to stop for other traffic. So while the traffic circles this city block clockwise, it circles the one beside it counterclockwise. And the one beside that is clockwise again. And if we zoom out a bit more, we can see that this is the pattern for the double T grid. Clockwise, counterclockwise, clockwise, counterclockwise. And similarly for the row above that and the row below, it's counterclockwise, clockwise, counterclockwise, clockwise. So if we zoom out a bit more, we can see that this idea scales really well. And another way to think about this idea is that we're moving away from the arterial model of roads. Instead of having a few big roads feeding into more medium-sized roads, and those roads feeding into even more smaller roads, this concept distributes traffic much more evenly around many, many small roads. So we're relying on the fact here that everybody's journey is different. Each journey is going to have a unique starting point and an end point. And traffic does not join up to get onto big roads and then split apart to go onto small roads, and so on. Okay, next, let's take a look at some of the journeys that are being made in this double T grid based city. So, okay, that's a good example. We can see here that these vehicles, instead of moving in long straight lines across the city and making just one or two turns, what they're doing is they're turning at almost every intersection. So instead of going all the way across here and then all the way up, they're going more or less diagonally across the city. Now, this of course is the same distance as going in a big straight line one way and then another straight line that way, but because the vehicles don't have to stop anywhere, it should actually be much, much faster. Now let's look at some other examples. Quiet over there. Okay, here we can see one of the drawbacks of this double T-based city. This vehicle in particular is having to go around many city blocks to go in a kind of a straight line in one direction. Now, there are ways to get around this problem, actually. What we can do, we can mix and match between a conventional one-way system with long straight lines with no interruptions and this double T grid based system. But that topic is probably worthy of a video on its own, so this is probably a good place to sign off on this video. So that's it for now. I hope you've enjoyed this introduction to the double T junction and the double T grid. Hit the like button if you did, and hopefully it's given you a few ideas for making improvements to your own cities. Now, I do plan to make some follow-up videos, probably one about this hybrid grid idea and another one explaining how I came up with these ideas in the first place. So hit subscribe if you want to be notified for when those videos are released. So, thanks for watching.